following our highest excitement, we align with the frequency that's most right.
Yes.
I see. Thank you.
Thank you. That's why I said it's the compass needle that points to your true magnetic north.
Excellent.
Thank you. There will be a brief amount of time remaining for this transmission. Next question.
Thank you, Bashar.
Any of you?
Actually, I don't have a question.
Oh, my congratulations.
Thank you.
Make a statement.
Oh, I'm following my highest excitement.
Thank you.
I'm following your advice. I have something that I'd like to share with the crowd because I think it's really important.
If you think so,
yes.
We'll see. Obviously, it's important to you.
It's important to me because I'm creating the alternate reality.
Oh, all right. And why is that?
Well, many people now, roughly 1 in 2 men and 1 in 3 women, are getting cancer.
Oh, right.
It's becoming an epidemic on this planet.
Yes.
And
the planet you're describing. The version of Earth you're describing.
Absolutely.
All right.
There's a man named Rick Simpson who discovered the cure for cancer and many other diseases. He dubbed it Phoenix Tears.
All right, stop. Understand something.
Yes.
There have been cures for cancer on your planet for decades.
Sure.
Every individual will attract themselves to what they need, and understand this as well. Sometimes an individual will attract themselves to an experience of a disease because that's actually one of the strongest experiences they can create for themselves to grow in the way that they wanted to. So even though it is possible that many people wish to transform the idea of a disease, many people actually do not because it actually serves the theme they are exploring. Let's just leave it at that for the moment. Thank you for your sharing. Good day. We will extend at this point to each and every one of you our deepest appreciation for the co-creation of this interaction, our unconditional love to you all, and we bid you all an exciting, creative, active good day. You said that you have 10 minutes in the time, so if anyone just has any questions for me about the channeling or anything like that, I'd be happy to take the 10 minutes to answer that.
I just have a question about your relationship to Bashar and how that has changed and what you think of merging with him as a time traveler. You talk about that.
Well, I mean, I understand, I don't know what he's explained to you today, but I understand he's definitely a different aspect of the greater being that I am, like different incarnations. Certainly channeling him has changed me a lot as a person. I get the sense I'm becoming my own version of him to the best of my ability on Earth. And the idea really is that, you know, when I'm in the channeling state, I have my own experience. It's like a daydream. I get feelings, I see pictures, I get downloads and things. I don't hear the words, but it does rub off on me. The concepts rub off on me. So that has changed me and allowed me to explore a lot of things. I think the thing that I always say that is one of the most profound experiences I have in the channeling, I get to feel the way they feel. They don't have one shred of a doubt about anything. Their conviction is total. That's such a profoundly different way from the way we operate, that just to be immersed in that conviction for even a few seconds is life-changing. So by being able to stand in the stream of that energy and feel the way they feel, I think has been what has really helped propel me toward doing what I need to do to become my own version of him as best as I can.
Why don't you describe who they are, that the time that the aliens say if you want to?
Yeah, it's just a lot of information there. Again, I don't know what he told you.
He didn't tell us anything about who he was.
Well, I mean, most of you are familiar with what's been called the alien abduction phenomenon, yeah?
Right.
Okay, well, I guess Bashar said that his race is one of the hybrid offshoots of the hybridization. People have reported seeing them creating hybrid beings from our genetics and their genetics. And I guess they created several hybrid civilizations, of which Bashar's is one. So he's described himself as a hybrid. They're about 5 feet tall on average, very slender, whitish gray skin, larger eyes than ours, relatively, you know, slender looking, smaller nose, smaller mouth, but more human than the grays, a real cross between the two. But they have a very advanced understanding of creation, very advanced technology with their ships. And they're basically, I mean, they don't use their language anymore, they're telepathic in their society. I think actually kind of one of the funniest things Bashar said that I never really stopped to think of, he says if you were to visit their planet, which is somewhat Earth-like, it's a little bit smaller, a little less gravity, more oxygen, we'd be a little dizzy for a while until we acclimated to it, more water on the planet, a slightly hotter star. He said, since they're all telepathic, if we were on their planet, we wouldn't hear very much. It would be very, very silent because nobody's talking. Everyone's just, you know, tapping into what they need to tap into. Now, they don't have any built-up cities on their planet. Their planet is mostly natural. Their cities are their spaceships. So they have, like, titanic, you know, city ships and mother ships, and that's really where they do all of their technological stuff. But the planet has been left relatively natural with very few structures on it. Relatively temperate over the whole planet, as he's explained it. In their ancient language, the planet is called Ephesani, actually recently shifted because they went through an energy change to Shatani, which basically means exalted light. They consider themselves to be beings of living light, just like they consider all of us to be, but they actually call themselves that. It's the third planet in their system, just as ours is. They're in an alternate reality, but if we were to overlap their reality with our reality, it would be about 500 light years in the direction of the Orion constellation, but we can't see their star unless we shift into their particular dimension. There's a lot more that he's explained. We're actually working on getting more information out, literally just about and who he is. We have actually begun working on a documentary about the channeling, how it became a channel, who Bashar is, what his civilization is about, and what the messages are about. So hopefully within the next couple of years, that documentary will also be available and will explain a lot of these things.
Well, the other key thing is the role of synchronicity in their society. It'd be great to talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, because they're absolutely trusting of the timing of things, everything in their world really operates synchronistically. They don't really have a government per se. They do have some form of organizational council, but it's really just all about, they always find themselves exactly where they need to be, when they need to be there, with whom they need to interact. Nothing is ever really planned. I mean, a good example of that, in a sense, is maybe what you heard today, because in terms of the talk he gave or the questions he may have answered, I mean, people have asked Bashar on the spur of the moment to do a two-hour workshop on a particular subject, and it's just there. It just comes out. He just knows what he needs to know, and he knows it. He says they don't actually even have memory. They just know what they need to know when they need to know it. So nothing is planned. Nothing is memorized. They just go into whatever state they need to go into and let everything happen by synchronicity. He's saying that's the way we are operating more and more and more. And as we go through the changes that we're seeing on our planet and start going to a higher level of presence, one of the symptoms, I guess, if you will, is to see more positive synchronicity in our lives, which I'm willing to bet more and more of you are starting to see and experience.
There's a question from the audience about, are there animals on their planet?
There are animals on their planet. However, he's described all the animal life on their planet as being symbiotic. None of it is predatory. He said the animals on our planet are predatory because we are. So it's just the way that our planet reflects this idea. It's not necessarily looked at as a negative thing by him, but he says that will change. And on their world, all the animals and everything have some kind of a coexistent relationship that's more symbiotic than predatory. Nothing kills anything else to survive.
Any final comments about time travel yourself, what you're aware of?
The only thing I can say about that is what I experience in the channeling, because when I go into the altered state, I know it's been about 90 minutes, time for me is exceedingly compressed. It's like the idea of doing what you love to do and not noticing, you know, it seems like, oh, I've only been doing this for 5 minutes, and you look up and 3 hours have gone by. It's like that. And really, from Bashar's perspective, that's actually what's happening, because he's actually said, we're creating the concept of So when you go into that state and you're doing something that you're so focused on, so involved in, and you really actually don't experience that passage of time, it says you literally haven't aged. In other words, if you experience 5 minutes, you age 5 minutes, not 3 hours. So when I go into the altered state, I may experience about 1/2 to 1/3 the time that the channeling actually took. So in that sense, time for me becomes very, very plastic, and I experience sort of it that way. So for me, it's kind of like it was 1.5 hours ago, and now I just jumped 1.5 hours ahead with very little time in between. To me, it sort of feels like time traveling when I wake up.
Question.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm Daryl. I'm not Bashar. I'm Daryl.
Yes, I'm just curious about relationships
between
Bashar and men and women and family.
On their planet? Relationships on their planet. They don't have structured relationships as far as I understand it. In other words, whatever the relationship needs to be is simply what it's allowed to be. And they don't really put any particular framework on it. They just let it be what it is. So, for example, if someone was going to be in what I guess we would call a monogamous relationship with someone, they wouldn't know it was monogamous until the end of their lives, because no one else came into it. So they would just let it be what it is. If it contains other people, it contains other people. They sort of look at the entire civilization as being in one marriage, and all of the children, in a sense, are the children of all the adults are the parents of all children. And remember, they're telepathically connected, so it's not like a child is ever out of sight to them. So they just really have a lot of freedom in the way that they relate to each other, in that sense. So thank you. I think we're
pretty much done. Bashar is going to be doing a talk on the 30th parallel.
Okay, your mic is going in and out.
Oh.
Yeah, well, this is going on April 13th at Angel Valley.
And then Los Angeles, June 14th and 16th.
Usually.
San Francisco, June 29th. You can go to Bashar.org.
Bashar.org.
Bashar.org?
Yeah, Bashar.org.
Okay, and thank you, Darryl.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
We'll take about an hour.